Welcome to part two. This part focuses on osteoporosis, osteomyelitis, and soft tissue injuries. Osteoporosis is a bone disease that is caused by alterations in the bone's resorption and formation rate. Normally, bone is reabsorbed and formed at the same rate so the bone stays strong and intact. In osteoporosis, the bones are reabsorbed much faster than they can be formed, resulting in loss of bone mass. The bones become porous, brittle, and fragile. This allows the bones to fracture easily under stress. Osteoporosis is the more prevalent bone disease in the world, causing more than 1.5 million fractures each year. The most common bones to fracture from osteoporosis are the spine, where the vertebrae actually compresses, the neck of the femur, and the wrist. In addition to fractures, osteoporosis can cause height loss, with an average of 2 to 3 inches of height lost due to bone loss. Taking steps to prevent osteoporosis may help slow or even totally prevent a person from developing the disease. Balanced diets that are high in vitamin C, calcium, and vitamin D over the lifespan may help prevent or minimize the disease severity. 20 to 30 minutes a day of weight-bearing exercises help stimulate bone formation as well as increases balance, which reduces the risk of falls and fractures. The treatment of osteoporosis may include the same prevention strategies, but depending on how bad the disease is, depends on what else we can do. Providers can prescribe calcitonin, which is a hormone that inhibits bone resorption. Bisphosphonates are another type of medications that can be given either orally or by IV to treat osteoporosis, or can be given to someone who is at high risk of developing the disease. Fosamax is a very common bisphosphate medication that is given orally and requires the person taking it to sit up for 20 minutes after taking it. This is really important as this medication can cause damage to the esophagus. There are some other IV hormonal medications that can be given, especially to postmenopausal women. Osteomyelitis is an infection of the bone. The usual causative bacteria is unfortunately methicillin-resistant Staphylococcus aureus, or MRSA, which is an antibiotic-resistant bacteria. Osteomyelitis can occur from a soft tissue infection or a pressure injury that's become infected, and that infection spread to the bone. It can occur with direct bone contamination from trauma or surgery or open fractures. It can be treated by an infection that has spread to the blood, called sepsis, and that blood infection has spread to the bone. In this case, usually the bone it infects has some sort of trauma or defect. It isn't common for sepsis to infect healthy bone. The treatment of osteomyelitis is geared towards stopping the infection, so very strong antibiotics are always given. Many times, surgery is needed to go in and debride the necrotic infected bone, and in some cases, the infection has destroyed so much bone and the person is so sick that amputation is the best treatment. Assuming the infection is in a bone that can be amputated, of course. The picture shows what the infection looks like on X-ray. If you can see, there is a little area of the bone that's been eaten away, and it also shows what that infection looks like on the outside on the skin. Soft tissue injuries are injuries that occur in the non-bone structures of the musculoskeletal system. There are several types of soft tissue injuries, and some of these you may have heard of from just growing up. The first soft tissue injury we see is a contusion. This soft tissue injury is produced by blunt force, and it's just a really bad bruise. Symptoms include pain, edema, and ecchymosis, which is bruising. Next, we have strains. Strains are damages caused to muscles or tendons, usually due to overstretching or tearing. Symptoms include pain, edema, muscle spasm, ecchymosis, and loss of function. The severity of the strain is graded on a continuum, first, second, and third degree. Next, we have sprains. Sprains are injuries to ligaments and supporting muscle fibers around a joint. You may have had a sprained ankle as a kid. Symptoms include pain that may increase with motion, edema, and tenderness. The severity of the sprain is graded according to the ligament damage and joint stability. Next, we have dislocations. Dislocations occur when the articular surfaces of a joint are not in contact, meaning the joint is out of its socket. A dislocation is an emergency and it causes significant pain. It changes the contour, the axis, and the length of the limb and loss of mobility to that limb. Lastly, we have subluxations. These are partial or incomplete dislocations, and they're not an emergency because it doesn't cause as much deformity as a complete dislocation, but it is still very painful. The best way to manage soft tissue injuries is to actually prevent them. Ways to prevent injuries include the use of proper equipment for what tasks or activities incurred, such as proper shoes, wrist guards, etc. Proper hydration and nutrition keeps the body functioning the best it can. Effective training, conditioning, and stretching specific for the person and the activity helps as well. When we treat soft tissue injuries, we like to discuss the RICE method. RICE stands for rest, ice, compression, and elevation of the injured body part. Rest helps avoid any movement for up to 48 hours. Ice on the injury for 20 minutes at a time, 4 to 8 times per day, helps decrease swelling and inflammation and pain. Compression provides support and decreases swelling. Elevation above the heart when resting helps reduce pain and swelling. Now, some injuries are worse than others, so the provider may change the amount of rest and may actually use an immobilizer to prevent any movement at all. And this is the end of osteoporosis, osteomyelitis, and soft tissue injuries.